Good evening. The regular meeting of the Southern Shores Town Council for February the 6th, 2018 is now in session. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Before I ask you to join me in a moment of silence, I would ask that you remember Linda Burek in your thoughts and prayers. Linda's husband, Regis, died about 3 weeks ago on January the 20th, to be exact, while they were away in Florida. Many of you may remember Linda from running for council about over 2 years ago, and she now serves as a treasurer of the SSCA. I've been privileged to work with Linda through my association with the Southern Shores Boat Club. And I felt it important to recognize her loss this evening. I thank you. Please join me in a moment of silence. Thank you. Council, I need a motion to approve the agenda.
So moved.
Thank you, Chris. Do I have a second? All in favor? Aye. Can I count votes here? You're in favor of it, Fred?
Yeah.
Thank you. All in favor. Motion's made and carried to approve the agenda. We have an agenda, gentlemen. I need a motion to approve the consent agenda, Council. Tab 1.
I'll move.
Thank you, Chris. Do I have a second to approve the consent agenda?
I'll second.
Thank you. All in favor?
I got one little minor issue with the meeting minutes. I remember last meeting when Sam Williams made a presentation to the council regarding a code right recommendation for vegetation of tree removal ordinance. And I made some comments about the benefits of trees, and that was not reflected in the minutes. So I think that would be a minor modification to the
Did you call it that at Sheila's attention when we got a copy of the minutes to review?
No, I did not. If you make that modification, add that, I'll agree to the minutes as written.
And that was part of it.
About where in the what line would you say that going through the, just if we had to make that? Just to give clear direction.
It had to be somewhere around line 139 to 140.
Well, as I recall, if you look at the video, there was evidently a technical problem, and that part of the video was not there.
Right.
I mean, and that's another thing we can talk about later. That needs to be resolved, that technical problem. But that may be why they were omitted. I don't know. But I reread them again today, and I noticed that was not in there. And I think my discussion should be part of the minutes.
If you can give us a statement that you think ought to be in
okay,
there, we'll put it in there verbatim, right? She can insert it.
I'll email it to you.
Is that okay, Fred?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Now, can we go back and get an approval of the consent agenda? Any further comments? I have a motion, have a second. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
The consent agenda has been approved. This time I'd like to call on Chief David Cole. Do recognize Sergeant Brad Eilert. Good evening, David.
Thank you, Mayor, members of council. Tonight is my privilege to recognize Southern Shores First Sergeant Brad Eilert. Just to give you a little bit of background, not as much as he had initially given me. Brad was born and raised in Petersburg, Virginia. He comes from a long list of family in law enforcement. His father is a retired chief of police in Petersburg, Virginia. I believe your sister is retired now. She was also a police officer, and he has a brother as well that was a police officer. Brad had 1 year with Wright County Sheriff's Department in Virginia. Then he spent the next 12 years with the town of Nag's Head before we were fortunate enough and blessed to pick him up. And he's been with the Southern Shores Police Department for 5 years. He's married to his wife, Becca, who is a nurse at the Outer Banks Hospital, and they have two children. What he's being recognized for tonight is his traffic enforcement investigation certification. And to give you, just in a nutshell, what the requirements are, he is actually only the 283rd officer in the state of North Carolina to receive such a certification. Some of the basic requirements, a minimum of 500 hours of training, which has to focus on both traffic enforcement as well as traffic investigations. Some of those other classes that include traffic crash investigations, intoximeter, DWI, as well as radar, and FSST, which is your field sobriety test training. Brad has successfully completed all that, and I would congratulate him on his state certification.
Thank you, Chief.
Brad.
Congratulations, Brad.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chief. Congratulations, Brad. At this time, I'd like to ask Karen Brown, President and CEO of the Outer Banks Chamber of Commerce, to speak to us. Come on up, guys. Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and members of the council. And let me assure you, I am not Karen Brown. But thank you for allowing us to be on the agenda tonight. I'm Bob Peel. I'm the current chairman of the board of the Chamber of Commerce. And Karen's not going to go far, because if I get in trouble, she's going to bail me out here. But I'm going to do the first part of this quick presentation.
Glad to have you with us.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you again for putting us on the agenda. We're here tonight to talk. Well, I'm here representing the full Chamber of Commerce and its nearly 1,000 members. That it has today. And we're here to introduce a new initiative that the Chamber of Commerce is working on that we think is extremely important to our community, and that is a community housing initiative. Now, we've actually formed a group, a group that's meeting regularly to discuss this issue. And we formed this because we've heard reports, and we're hearing this all the time now, about the concerns that our businesses have about the lack of housing and housing that is affordable for workers in the area. But right now, the working group includes the Outer Banks Chamber of Commerce, of course, the Association of Realtors here on the Outer Banks, the Outer Banks Home Builders Association, the Restaurant Association, the county and town officials, and that's, we're here tonight to sort of introduce this to y'all. Business owners and managers throughout the community, developers, realtors, and of course, we have concerned citizens sitting at the table too. Oh, she's pushing the button. Thank you. Okay, they know what she was doing. Okay. So for the last 3 years, the Chamber of Commerce has had what's called a business retention and expansion program to help our local businesses grow and survive And every year we send out a survey to them. And we hit on a lot of different topics in this survey. What are your concerns? What are your needs? Can we help you? What do we need to do to help you? And every year, the first answer or the biggest issue for our businesses or the second biggest issue, depends from year to year, it's always housing. It's always housing. We're hearing this constantly now. Just last year, the chamber sent out a survey to the membership of the chamber, and housing and the lack thereof of a housing that's affordable was the biggest issue. So that's kind of what led to this creation of this group, so we could start having conversations. In that survey last year, 75% of the businesses surveyed said that, or indicated that, housing is a critical issue for finding and retaining their workforce. So what do we need to do? We need to talk about and figure out something to do about year-round housing opportunities, seasonal housing opportunities. Our inability to fill professional jobs and loss of our workforce. I'm still on this one. Okay. We practice this, believe it or not. Inability to fill year-round service industry and entry-level positions is an inability to fill seasonal positions. My goodness, our seasonal workforce is having a terrible time finding places to live. I'll give you an example, the Outer Banks Hospital. This isn't just our seasonal workers, though. Our Outer Banks Hospital has lost some employees, and these are professional staff people that were professional staff people that specialized in specific medical areas. They've lost people because of housing. These people come here, they accept the jobs or whatever, realize they can't live here. College of the Albemarle has lost, that I've heard, at least two instructors who actually accepted jobs, came down here, and left shortly thereafter because they couldn't find housing. And of course, Dare County tells us. Dare County is at our meetings, and they're telling us they're having trouble filling jobs for the county. And housing is a huge issue there, and a big part of that. So it really is becoming a crisis. So affordable housing, workforce housing, we don't want to get caught up in the stigmas or the misconceptions of what it might be. We're trying to focus on housing that is available and reasonably priced for everyone within our community, professionals and everybody you can think of. So our summer workforce, so who needs it? Teachers. Our police officers, EMTs, firefighters, ocean rescue, college graduates, retail restaurant staff, professionals, the doctors, the lawyers, accountants, contractors, seasonal workers. Every one of our meetings, we have contractors there who talk about we've got jobs, we will hire people, but we can't because the people we need to hire can't come down here or can't stay here. It really is becoming a problem. So what's the potential impact of this? Well, we lose citizens. Our citizen retention is going to drop. Business owner fatigue. We're hearing stories from restaurant owners who are putting in 70, 80 hours a week just because they can't find help. So the owners themselves are there every day and all day, it sounds like. And the fatigue is unbelievable. We're missing economic development opportunities, you know, trying to bring small new businesses in, but the housing is a huge issue with that. Customer service, our ability to keep customers happy and provide them with good service. Impact, worker fatigue is a part of that. There's an economic impact on this. If we can't provide good service to the people that visit here, people may decide to go elsewhere. So there could be long range impacts of this problem. How's it made affordable? Well, here's where we are. We're trying to be innovative. It has to be a collaborative effort. That's why we want to get people around the table, including folks from the towns and the managers and planners for the towns. We'd like to have them join us around the table. We've got to look at possible land use planning, permitting issues, zoning, density, multi-family housing units, and even mixed-use development. We're not suggesting that current homeowners that try to fix this or we try to fix that fix the issue through them necessarily. We've got to think sort of innovatively and creatively here, and it does need to be a collaborative effort, we believe. We really do. The benefits of multifamily housing and affordable housing units, including ADUs, is there's several up there, but, you know, we're talking about promotes workforce housing at a small scale. We're not talking, you know, we're not talking about huge developments here that are nothing but workforce housing. This can be done throughout our neighborhoods, possibly. Provides workforce housing at no expense to the public. If it's a, something that private property owners can do by doing it throughout the neighborhoods and or however we do it, we, you know, it provides a convenient location for our workers so they can get to work easily, and you know, it can even provide additional income for property owners. So you see a list of benefits there. So, and these are just some of them that our group has identified. So why are we here? What are we here for tonight? What's the ask, as we call it? We're trying to start the conversation. Now, this is not a new conversation. I've been down here 20 years, and I've been hearing about housing problems since I got here. But it's a conversation that needs to continue, and it's a conversation where we need to get everybody involved. Again, getting the local planning teams from the towns and government involved is a huge benefit to this effort, because we need to become aware of what each town desires and allows and that kind of thing. We need to work collaboratively with all the stakeholders, and this is a very interesting group of people. We've got a real mix of people sitting around the table, and the input has been really good. And so that's why we're here tonight, just to let you know this is going on, and we'll hope enough that your town manager, I think, Peter's been to one or two of the meetings, or some of the meetings already. We're just getting started, and your planning department, we'd love to have them involved too, because we need those folks to weigh in on the real issues. And Karen Brown is here. She's going to she's here to save me now. But that's sort of the presentation, and she's going to explain the other handouts you have in front of you.
I just also handed out this information from the North Carolina Housing Coalition. You have one for Dare County, housing needs in Dare County, and one for Currituck, because it is a regional issue that we're dealing with. And I just pulled this off their site the other day. I think the most important statistic on there is on the bottom of that front page. It says 39% of renters and 37% of homeowners have difficulty affording their homes in Dare County. I think that speaks a lot to the lack, and again, it's not the affordable, cheap housing. We're just looking for something that's reasonable for folks that they can purchase, or that they can come into the community and rent until they're ready to purchase, you know, to make their purchase once they get to know the community. I do want to say it's not, as you all know, it's not an issue that's unique to the Outer Banks. I talked to a lot of chambers around the country, and a lot of the tourism resort areas are all dealing with the same issue. And there are some creative things that they're doing that, you know, we're going to look into and possibly put before some folks as well, and see if we can do some of those same items. So that's what we had.
We'll be glad to try to answer questions. Well, Karen will be glad to try to answer any questions. And we thank you for letting us get on the agenda tonight. We really do appreciate it.
Thank you. Just stick around a second, see if we have anybody besides me who wants to ask a question.
Council, anyone have thoughts or questions?
I have a question. The ones directly benefiting from, say, the seasonal help are the business owners. So I guess what I'm asking is, what are the business owners doing to resolve this problem?
I can tell you that some of the ones that sit around our table are purchasing homes when they come on. That's one of the other issues. When a reasonably priced home comes on the market, they grab it up to house their seasonal workers in, which is good for the seasonal workers, but it takes away that year-round potential or that reasonably priced house that somebody could have purchased. So it's kind of a, you know, it's that
catch-22
conundrum that we're in, you know. But they, a lot of them are doing that, I know. We've also, I know I had an inquiry a couple months ago from a larger business that wanted to come into the community, and they wanted to talk about the community. And I asked them, you know, if you came into the community, would you consider in your plan planning for some housing for your potential employees as part of your plan for coming in here, you know, because that's an issue for us. So I think we have to kind of put it back to them a little too.
So what do they do with the property after the season's over? It doesn't just sit vacant, does it?
I don't know. Truthfully, I don't know. I suspect it sits vacant. I truly do.
Or rent it out for the winter,
for a winter
season,
rental.
But then
yeah.
Come season, okay. So it may remain a rental, but it's all short term.
Right.
So,
okay. Thank you.
No, I just wondered. You know, one of the problems I was with the school system. We did that parcel down there behind the schools at Kildevil Hills. One of the problems we faced was you don't have any land to put housing on. Mm-hmm. And if you put housing on it, it becomes more unaffordable than anybody can acquire. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we looked to the Man's Harbor, the East Lake areas, mm-hmm. but then you got the transportation issue for seasonal workers. So I don't know. I don't have an answer for you, but I know that land is very valuable here again.
Yes, sir. And those issues that you mentioned are still there.
Right.
Regretfully, that hadn't been resolved.
And, you know, when they started looking at financing and things, they were very fortunate, and Dave Oaksmith did a lot of work on that. Mm-hmm. But it was a difficult task just mm-hmm. to put some housing in place for teachers at that point. It's been an ongoing problem now, I guess, for over 20 years here.
It's not going to be easy to solve by any means, but we hope we can think creatively enough and find those pockets of land and maybe try to figure out transportation for some of that, too. So that's also why we're working regionally with Currituck, because we feel like there might be some opportunity in up there as well.
This goes back a long time. This goes back a long time. It goes back to my youth. But, you know, it's many, many years. And I worked for different companies through my college years and on large construction projects. And we had a major part of our workforce that lived 50 and 60 and 70 miles away from where we worked. And they would had buses and carpools that would bring these slave people into work. And they were people you had to have. They were skilled people that knew how to do a job, so you couldn't just ignore them. And employers found a way to provide transportation for them and housing at some location. Many of them lived, you know, far out in their own home, but would catch these pool buses back into work every day. And that's one approach we might consider trying here, because you can go west of here to Columbia and you can find less expensive land, and you might be able to pool some resources and make that work. Gary hit it on the head. We don't have the land really to get, as an individual town, to get involved in providing this type of location. But it is a serious problem. I recognize it. Lots of friends in the restaurant business, and they tell me the same thing you're telling me tonight. Anyway, I appreciate your presentation to us tonight, and thank you for your time.
Thanks for the opportunity. Appreciate it.
Thank you. This time I'll, thanks Sheila. This time I'll call the town planner. Good evening, Wes.
Thank you and good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. I have a brief report for you tonight for the month of January 2018. There were 6 zoning permits issued, 33 building permits issued, which consisted of 1 new single family dwelling, 2 additions, 3 remodels, 3 repairs, 1 addition remodel, 1 accessory, and 22 others. There are currently 23 single-family dwellings under construction in the town, and the total amount of fees collected was $14,944.10. With respect to the upcoming planning board meeting, that will be held on February 20th. That is a Tuesday instead of Monday due to the President's Day holiday. And on the agenda, the board will be considering 2 variance applications, both of them seeking relief on the side setback requirements for 2 50-foot wide lots located at 155 Ocean Boulevard. The board will also consider 2 zoning text amendment applications, one submitted by the Southern Shores Crossing LLC to amend Section 36-163 off-street parking requirements to allow shared parking. The other ZTA was submitted by town staff to amend Section 36-175, wireless telecommunication sites and towers, to allow small wireless facilities and the use and installation of utility poles in accordance with 2017 legislation adopted by the General Assembly. Any questions?
Any questions, Council? Thank you, Wes.
Thank you.
Wes, what kind of remodel is Food Lion going to do?
It's all interior. It's a long list of things. Honestly, I couldn't tell you exactly what it all comes down to, but it was a good chunk for a permit.
There's been a lot of questions about what they're doing outside, and I know that has to do with septic fields.
Yes, sir. Their previous septic system was failing, and they're completely replacing it.
Because folks thought they were
doing the development.
Building that was Starbucks and those types of things.
Yeah, I saw lots of rumors on social media, but that's the septic replacement. The area where the development was approved, you all approved, is the repair area. Then off of Juniper is the main area for the septic system. Correct.
Well, that's good. It's about time they remodeled inside up there.
Thank you, Wes. Appreciate it.
Yes, sir.
Our police chief, David Cole. Good evening again, David.
Evening again, Mayor, members of council. January 2018 police report. As you can see down at the bottom, there was 1,788 calls for service for the month of January. Under the incidents, which are also reported crimes, excuse me, we had 5 total, 1 fraud, 1 vandalism, 1 trespassing, and the 2 others, one was an unattended death that we investigated, and the other one was an overdose that the officers were able to save with Narcan. We made 4 criminal arrests. We had a total of 4 motor vehicle accidents for January. Officers conducted 85 traffic stops. Out of 85 traffic stops, they issued 18 written citations and another 37 warning citations. And that's my report. Any questions?
Thank you. Questions, Council? Thank you, David. Ed Limbacher, our fire chief. Evening, Ed.
Evening, Mayor, Council. The fire department for the month of January responded to 51 calls, 3 structure fires, 2 patient assists, or sorry, 3 patient assists, 25 EMS calls, 1 each of hazardous condition, overheated motor, a water leak, smoke condition, 1 animal rescue, public service, 1 assisted police, 1 standby, 4 alarms, and 2 vehicle accidents, 1 with injuries and 1 without. Again, a total of 51 this last month. Anybody have any questions?
Any questions, Council? Thank you, Ed.
You're welcome.
Appreciate
Thank
it.
You.
Town manager's report, Beter.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. Tonight, I wanted to just remind that the fire department's architect will be coming to make a presentation to you at your March 6th meeting. As was discussed last year, when he got to this point in his design process, he would come and present to the council. And earlier that day, he'll be giving setting up in this room at 3 o'clock p.m. for an informational session, which we will be advertising for the public to be able to come and talk to him and look at drawings at 3 o'clock that afternoon. So he'll be having some images of his design to show that day, as well as present to you for discussion at your March meeting. I did remind the council that the Yopon Trail Camel Major permit had been issued about 10 days ago. We were anxiously awaiting that, and currently with that permit, we're able to get the structural design underway for a planned extension of the bulkhead into the canal there for that street. As soon as that's ready, we hope to bid that out as quickly as possible and also meet with the residents on the street again to inform them of what the timetable would be. Once the bulkhead is extended out, there'll be a waiting period for compaction anyway between then and the first round of street improvement, actual street improvement on that street. I did want to report to you, there have been several calls about the light at East Dogwood Trail and NC-12 intersection being slow. NCDOT has known about that, and they have a replacement mechanism underway, under design, to be able to replace the weight trigger for that intersection. It was damaged during their paving of NC-12. They know that, and every time we get a complaint, we pass it on to Division 1 in Edenton. They're aware of it, and it's under design to fix, is all I can report back. Beach survey is almost complete. As you know, the coastal engineer that the council contracted with has been conducting a beach profile study of the entire town beach, not only the town portion that was nourished, but also the rest of the town. And he called me today to inform me they're almost completed with that, and he will be here as March 6th as well to present the findings of that study to the council. And finally, I wanted to recognize David Bradley tonight. David is the town's new public works director. David is a native of Rocky Mount. He's a graduate of East Carolina University with a degree in construction management. And his prior employers were the North Carolina Department of Transportation and the town of Nags Head. And David's wife works for the Dare County Department of Social Services. So we're happy to have David on board. He's been on board as the director for several weeks now and been very busy. So we welcome him. And I'll be glad to try to answer any questions that the town council may have on operations.
Council, any questions?
Welcome. Good to have you on board.
I have one question. You may recall at the December council meeting, Claire Sutton made a presentation and gave us this handout of several residents' concerns about stormwater problems, so runoff over on Fairway. Has any action been taken or any responses been provided to those citizens? Or?
No, sir. No action's been taken by the council on that, on a capital improvement on that street. There have been two CIIP committee meetings, one prior to that and one after that, and it's never come up by the council members that attended the committee meeting. Staff considers it as a capital improvement if that's what the council wants to do. And that's certainly something that council could direct us to do, is it would be in the form of a capital improvement on that street.
Considering there are quite a few people that made signed statements and had concerns, I think it would be appropriate to refer it to the capital improvement committee.
And I can do that as a staff member at their meeting tomorrow, or one of the two committee chairs can bring that up as well. It can be considered like every other capital improvement.
Yeah, I just think we need to be responsive to the people over there. Does that need to be in a motion, or can staff provide?
No, because we're considering every street in town as a capital, potentially every street in town. So that can certainly be considered by the committee.
Yeah, we can go on the list for the CIIP committee to look at.
I'm sorry?
We can go on the list with that for the CIIP committee to look at. We can put that on our list of things to look at.
Okay.
I've personally been on that street now four or five times after pretty severe rainstorms. Mm-hmm. And I see no evidence of the issues that were being claimed as that actually happened. So that's all I can say to that, is I don't see the evidence of that flooding that everybody that's being talked about by those people. Just don't see it.
Well, I'm not going to say. I really don't know. But the fact is, she made a presentation, and there are citizens that made comments. And
she should be responded to.
Yes.
Yeah. Thanks.
That's my point.
She came in and... My recollection is that she came in and then was told that she needed signatures, and she went back and got them.
And right. She got them, and they're in this package here.
We've also got the Capital Improvements Committee meeting this week that people are welcome to attend to help us as we prioritize these street improvements.
Well,
that's another avenue there also.
This one's a was a street improvement that created an issue according to the residents.
Well, not according to all the residents on that street, though. I've talked to many residents that are fine with what was done down there. So, I mean, there's two sides to these stories, but my point is that this week, the Capital Improvements Committee is meeting. They're welcome to come and help us prioritize these projects.
Anything further, Council?
Well, as I understand it, she was told to get those signatures and come before Council. She did it. And I think she put together a pretty comprehensive package. Whether you agree with the people or not, it should be responded to. Some action should be taken.
And we're going to do that by having a CIP committee address
it. Okay.
I think we talked about that.
Okay, good.
Thank you. Town attorney?
I don't have anything to report, Mr. Mayor. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Sam Williams, planning board report. Good evening, Sam.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, Council.
I just wanted to start my presentation with recognizing the fact that there was a big article on the planning board meeting in the January 28th issue of the Coastland Times. It was above the fold. That's how important it was. It must have been a slow news day. And tonight I've already talked to the photographer and asked if it ever happens again, if he could take more photos so my picture could be better than it was. But anyway, if you read the article, you've got a basic understanding of my tonight's presentation. The first thing I would like to talk about is the side yard setbacks for 50-foot wide lots. As a bit of background, the 50-foot wide lots were platted before the town was incorporated. And if you look at a map of the town lots, you'll see that the entire coast is filled or nearly filled with 50-foot wide lots. And a lot of those lots currently are owned by two people. Two lots side by side are owned by one person, and some of these large houses have been built on them. The side yard setbacks for the entire town were once 10 feet wide and was changed to 15 feet, and the 15-foot limit is what it currently is. On these 50-foot wide lots, if you take a 15-foot side setback on each side of these 50-foot lots, it results in a 20-foot wide house, which isn't much larger than a single wide trailer. And so far, the planning board, acting as Board of Adjustment, has approved three variances requesting that the side yard setbacks be increased from or decreased from 15 feet to 12 feet. And it doesn't sound like much, but it increases the width of the houses to 26 feet wide. And if you want to know what that looks like, just north of the Chickahawt light, you'll see two houses under construction, and those two houses are constructed on those lots that we approved two of the variances for. So the issue that we looked at was, should the side yard setback requirements for 50-foot wide lots be changed? And some of the things that the planning board considered was the fact that we had approved three variance applications because they were unique, and we wondered if the planning board has now established a pattern of smaller houses on smaller lots. And the other thing that we discussed was these cases where one owner owns two lots, and what if they want to tear down the house that's there and redevelop each lot separately? And we have not dealt with that as a variance yet. The other thing that we looked at was the current land use plan. And in the current land use plan, it says that we want to, the town wants to comply with the founder's original vision, which is a low-density residential community comprised of single-family dwellings on large lots. The other thing we talked about was if these variance requests come up over and over and over again because the number of 50-foot wide lots that exist, the work on the Board of Adjustment is going to increase tremendously in the future. And there's a certain cost associated with that because the town has to hire a lawyer for the Board of Adjustment in those cases. The bottom line is that the Planning Board recommended no changes to the town code regarding the side setback requirements. We recognize that the Board of Adjustment may just have to handle increased numbers of these variance requests. The second thing we discussed was parking requirements for residential rental homes. The concern there is that there are just too many cars are parked in some of these rental homes, way past the assigned parking. The problem occurs mostly in the summer, and I think one of the things that we looked at pretty hard was the distinguishing between rental homes and non-rental homes would be difficult, and therefore enforcement would be difficult. And we also recognize that it's unsightly and may cause some traffic problems if somebody tries to back out onto the street. But the recommendation was no changes to the town code regarding parking on rental properties. The third thing that we discussed was commercial development design standards. Now, if you remember on the survey, there were two questions related to the issue of commercial development design standards. One was a specific question, and when we talk about design standards, we're talking about requiring particular aesthetic items such as pitch roofs or preferred building materials on commercial building. And in the one question, there was a 68% agreement that we should have some design standards. The other one compared, would you rather have these design standards or encourage new businesses to locate here in town? And again, the design standards won out. The issue was tabled by the Planning Board until we looked at other Dare County towns that have design standards. Three other towns have design standards, Duck, KDH, and Nag's Head. And as soon as we discuss that, we'll be back with a recommendation. The last thing, next to last thing, or maybe this is the last thing that we discussed was relocation of oceanfront houses. The issue there is it was recommended, or the question in the survey was whether the town code should remove obstacles to moving homes away from advancing high tide line on the deeper oceanfront lots. And 67% supported the removal of obstacles to moving the homes away from advancing tide. And we recognize that almost all of these oceanfront lots are very deep. And a request to move oceanfront homes back from the ocean is rare. More could be questioned after a hurricane or a strong storm hits, it's something that, with the deep lots that we discussed. And among the things that we discussed was the town codes on hurricane and storm reconstruction requirements, the town's oceanfront setback requirements, and the current CAMA oceanfront setback requirements. It was recognized that the CAMA rules don't cover all of the town's hurricane and storm reconstruction requirements. And the recommendation from the Planning Board is that no changes to the town code be made regarding relocating oceanfront homes. We felt that the existing situation could be held without, or, you know, dealt with without modifying the town code. That's my report. Do you have any questions?
Counsel? Question, Sam, on the, you talked about, well, two, actually. You talked about the parking requirements for rental. What about the issue that's going to hit us with the parking for accessory structures? Would that, did y'all discuss that?
We did not discuss that specifically.
Well, like because we were talking in a VROB?
Right, but we did not discuss that specifically because the issue was a large number of cars, and the descriptions that we talked about was these rental homes that are particularly on the oceanfront with large numbers of cars.
Right, but with this, or we may have situations where we have, you know, the homeowner there and then a number of vehicles coming in. There may not be, but it may be something we need to look at.
Yes, and I think when we're talking about accessory structures, one of the things that was recognized that the number of cars parked at the accessory structures probably would not be very large, you know, one or two, and would not be the issue as far as, you know, looking ugly, if you will.
Well, a residential, if you got two cars or three cars and then you add two more, you know, they may be on the streets and that type of thing.
That's correct, but we run into that same situations in a lot of houses in town, some houses in town where there's a husband and wife and three teenagers.
Right.
The same sort of issue.
The other question I had was, when you talked about relocating oceanfront homes, you know, the last structures I've seen go up, they've cut into the dune, which is legal. So should we maybe go back and look at increasing the setback on the ocean side for those homes so they don't cut into that dune? Because 10 years from now or 5 years from now, they may be coming to us saying, we want you to fill or to pump sand on our beach because they damaged that dune. And with the storms that we get and those kinds of things, it could eat away at it very quickly. So did y'all look at maybe moving? They have deep lots locating them further back toward the road away from the ocean.
We did not look specifically at cutting into the dune and for that reason moving the requirement that houses be moved back, you know, on the lot.
Down on Ocean Boulevard right now where we've got two homes going up and the whole lots are just stripped of vegetation completely all the way up and into the dune. Even if they replant, you're still going to have some issues there eventually because they took away part of the dune that was protecting their house.
Yes, we did not discuss damaging the dune during construction.
Doesn't CAMA have pretty strict requirements as far as impact on the dune and setbacks from the dune?
I think they do. When you start getting on that frontal dune, you start getting CAMA regulations and CAMA eyes on this thing pretty severely.
But if you look at those two are the last two that I've looked at, they've cut significantly into dune. And I know that's not the front dune out there, but it's the back side of it. And the bottom line is they're gonna want us to re-nourish that beach eventually out there. And you take away the dune, you've taken away. And what if you look at where they nourished down in Kitty Hawk and put up the sand fence is almost completely covered now. The dune's rebuilt on that. Of course, one storm could take it away in about an hour, but right now that's really helped that beach right out there in front of that section. And, you know, it's just protecting our beach.
So what would you have the planning board look at?
Look at increasing the setback on the ocean side. Keep from hitting the dune at all.
you would have to map the toe of the dune on the landward side as part of all the development processes.
You said you would like the planning board to look at that. Is the council directing the planning board to look at that?
You don't make that a motion, Gary? Or you,
do I need to do that, or can we direct it?
I don't think it's
necessary. I don't think council can direct it without a motion from somebody.
I make a motion that we direct the planning board to look at Oceanside setback and the need to maybe increase it to protect our dunes in the future.
Moving those properties, or before they can be built, moving them further to the west, essentially.
Right.
Do I have a second to that motion?
Yes, I'll second it.
Any further discussion, council?
Gary mentioned two properties on Ocean Boulevard, but on other parts of Ocean Boulevard, there's the same problem. I noticed one today. They've really cut into that dune, and I don't see how the integrity of the dune's going to be maintained, so I think it's a good idea to increase the setback.
They're cutting into the integrity of the dune on the landward side, on the west side.
Yes,
no,
that's correct.
On the ocean side.
No, but then you're cutting.
Oh, yeah, I'm with you, Tom.
Okay. It's on the land side, but the dune is not as strong as it was before.
And existing camera requirements don't address this?
No.
Where would this setback be measured from? First line of vegetation, the top of the dune, the property line?
It'd be something to investigate and look at.
Yeah, I agree.
I'm not going to say this much, but when you look at, when you go out there, and you know, you go north on Ocean Boulevard, there's been several new structures built on the front. They just go out there and drag that sand back, build it up, and they've cut into that dune structure.
They're balancing their cut and fill.
Yeah, 5 to 10 feet. And if you go in 5 feet into the back of the dune, you're destroying a lot of vegetation forward of that.
Okay, I'm not seeing the need for this, but okay.
I'll be honest with you, I'm not either. I think that's a bit of an oversimplification. In terms of the clear cutting, there's not there on these lots we're talking about, particularly the oceanfront ones, there aren't a whole lot of trees there anyways.
We're not talking clear cutting.
Well, but I mean, in terms of clearing out vegetation.
We're talking integrity of our beach front.
But that's fine. I mean, that's okay. But I'm not seeing a whole lot of need for it. I guess I'm going to agree with Jim. CAMA has rules for this. We've never even heard about any such rules within different towns or counties within the Outer Banks. I don't know.
I think we're also starting to tread in some very complicated area with all the CAMA regulations and the floodplain VE zones, and there's just.
It's not so simple.
It's not that simple.
But we can establish a setback.
Well, before we change it, I'd like to see that there's a problem, though.
Well, we just filled about a mile of beach out there with beach sand.
That's not relating to this problem, though. That's not relating to this.
Yeah.
Dune integrity.
Yeah, but
well, the dune integrity was fine from the landward side. It was from the ocean side.
Exactly. And if they looked at where they were losing it at the toe of the dune from the ocean side, and then what would happen is it would fall over. They didn't address the other side, and even our beach nourishment isn't addressing that side either, intentionally so.
Right. Well, it's cutting in below it, too, man.
Let me make a comment on that. I remember Hurricane Isabel came, 10 years ago?
2003.
Yep, well, it was more than 10 years ago. And on Ocean Boulevard, and I know because I got property near there, across the street at the beach, that dune was pretty much gone on the ocean side. And the only thing that held the water back was on the land side. And that dune was, that integrity was preserved. If we had people going in and digging into that dune, then water would have come over.
Makes you more vulnerable.
a lot more vulnerable, and we'd have flooded. I mean, that's the risk we have with property there. But the thing is, if we can preserve those dunes as well as we can, they do give us a certain amount of protection and reduce the risk of flooding. So I think what Gary's motion is all about is preserving the dunes, and I think it's a good idea.
We're about to request that the planning board go back and look at this setback issue without really understanding all the forces, all the setbacks, all the restrictions that are in play with all the pieces of property this may affect.
I don't understand what you're saying, sir.
Well, we have camera regulations that's been referenced, for example.
That has nothing to do with us having a setback.
It might. I think it does.
Well, we have to be inside of it, but other than that, the camera's a whole total different thing.
I think we're just jumping off into a wild goose chase right now without fully looking at the whole thing. I think
that's why I asked that they look at it. I think it's going to be an issue for us, and nourishments come up when we know that's going to be ongoing. We need to protect those beaches as best we can.
I'd rather keep them focused on Module 1 right now rather than chasing this.
Chasing?
Yes.
So you don't want to protect our beaches?
He didn't say that.
Yes, he did.
No, he did not say that.
That dog don't bite with me, Gary.
Sir?
That dog don't bite with me.
Can you call for a vote?
Yes. Council, we have a motion on the floor to ask our planning board to investigate and possibly establish some setback requirements on the landward side of the dune. Is that what we've got on the floor? Did I express that okay?
Yes, you did.
Pretty good for the whole
time. You did a good job.
It's best you've done it.
We have a second to that motion. We've had a discussion about that motion. At this time, I would ask for all who are in favor of asking this be sent back to the planning board, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed to sending it back to the planning board, same sign.
Aye.
So we're not going to ask the planning board right now to do this, the way I understand it. Thank you. At this time, I'll open general public comment.
Are there any other questions?
I'm sorry, Sam.
Thanks, Sam.
I apologize.
Thanks, Sam.
I should have excused you, Sam. I apologize. Becky Whitehorse. Good evening, Becky.
Okay, now for something totally different. Thank you very much, gentlemen and ladies, for letting me speak tonight. My name is Becky Whitehorse. This is my husband, Kevin Williams. Let me preface my remarks by saying everything I know about town council meetings I learned from watching the Gilmore Girls on TV. So you're going to have to excuse my naivete. So this is my first one, and it's been fascinating, I have to say. So we've had a rental house here in Southern Shores for about a year, and then in October we bought a beach house on Ocean Boulevard right by those couple of lots, but that has nothing to do with my story or my request. So what I'm here to talk about is we live on the beach, and we have dogs, and we're very involved with dog rescue, and we actually have 4 dogs of our own. Our dogs love, love, love the beach, and they are going to be very upset when May 1st rolls around and they can no longer go for their 2 p.m. beach stroll. So what we are asking, my husband and I, and I'm sure there's others in the community, we are asking to revisit the May through September 9 a.m., 6 p.m. no dogs on the beach statute. I understand this has been talked about quite a bit and got a lot of information about it, but I'd like to talk about it again and see if there's some way that we can figure out a compromise. We understand that not everybody loves dogs and that this is an issue that has to factor in local tourism. But is it possible that we can work it out that the beachfront property owners can have more hours on the beach with their dogs? Not everyone wants more hours with their dogs, but those of us who live on the beach, it is a constant calling to go out there with them, and we're just hoping that we can get a little bit more time with our dogs out there during the season, even if it is just a couple of hours. We would like to propose changing the statute to allow leashed dogs on the beach before 10 a.m. during the season and after 4 p.m. So that's adding 1 hour in the morning and 2 hours in the afternoon. And it would make a huge difference for those people who want to be able to take their dogs on the beach by just giving us more flexibility. So we are very responsible dog owners, but we understand that not all dog owners are so. So an idea, perhaps to weed out irresponsible dog owners, we could implement a permit system. So that would be tied to when you obtain a license for your dog. Maybe owners could obtain a yearly beach permit for each dog when they renew their annual license. It's something to maybe reward those of us who are responsible dog owners. And like I said, if someone is going to go to all the trouble to get a voluntary license, chances are they are a responsible dog owner. Personally, we would be happy to pay and get yearly payment if it meant our boys could have more access to the beach, and I bet there are a lot of other people out there as well. So it's an added income, probably a small one, but an added income revenue for that community. So in summary, it just seems wrong to deprive our best friends of spending a lazy summer afternoon under an umbrella at the beach. Our dog, oh, okay, do I have to stop?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Matt Neal. Good evening, Matt.
Good evening. Thank you for letting me speak tonight. My name is Matt Neal. I grew up in Southern Shores, and now I'm a resident of Southern Shores. And while there's lots I would like to comment on tonight's meeting, there are three specific issues. Specifically, workforce housing, often it was talked about seasonal workers. As a business owner on the Outer Banks, it goes far beyond seasonal workers. It's every day. Our employees, we do not have enough staff. We cannot find them. They need housing. I appreciate the movement the council made on accessory dwelling units because that helps alleviate some of the housing stress, and that could continue to be looked at as a relief for the chamber's proposal to you all. Everybody here is a stakeholder in this issue because it's just going to continue to get worse. Second comment is regarding the upcoming zoning text amendment that you're going to consider. I think lot coverage in the town of Southern Shores is something that should be reevaluated and looked at separately or in conjunction with stormwater management. Currently, there are no pervious surface relief allowed within the town zoning. We see a lot of driveway sheeting from rainwater. That's often what contributes to lot flooding. If we could have a benefit to a property owner to use pervious surfaces, I think you would increase that and it would help drive stormwater management within the town in a responsible manner. And I think that is something that I'm proud to see you all revisit and have part of the discussion. My third comment is more of a fun one. As a neighbor to the proposed structure that's going to be added to the Historic Landmarks Commission, I think we need to preserve more of these flat tops. They are a signature of our town, of our region, and they speak for a vernacular of the Outer Banks that reaches all across to the west coast of the Eichler homes out there. And it's a unique thing that we share on this beach, and we need to preserve it at the best of our abilities. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Lorelei DiBernardo. Good evening, Lorelei.
Hi. Good evening. Thank you for letting me talk. I just wanted to urge the council tonight to approve Resolution 2018-0201, which opposes the proposed National Outer Continental Shelf oil and gas leasing program. This plan brings unacceptable risks to both our oceans, our coast, our communities, our residents, our economy, and our climate, and I also support scheduling additional public hearings by the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management, and to extend that input period to hear the citizens' voice, to hear the voices of coastal residents. And I applaud your proactive response to this issue and encourage its adoption tonight by council. Thank you.
Thank you. Steve Gutis. Good evening.
Good evening, sir. Good evening, Mayor and members of council. We'll try to make this very quick. Our home in 156 Wax Myrtle Trail is up for consideration for historic designation by the Historic Landmark Commission. I'd like to thank several people on this long road that we've come to here. First of all, the town council for establishing this historic commission. I think this shows a lot of vision, and this was a wonderful move. I'd like to thank the Historic Landmark Commission, Lee Whitley being the chairman themselves, who got this together and are putting it all together. I'd like to thank Wes Haskett, your town planner, who is most professional and most easy to deal with, and it's been wonderful. It's been like a long serpentine go, not really serpentine, but kind of a long way to go up that. I'd like to thank my wife for all her organization, for the tours and everything else she's done over the years. It's been really amazing and quite a thing recognizing. I first walked into this home that I owned in 1985, and I said, someday I want to own this house. My knees got weak as I saw this paneling, and I said, my God, I feel like I'm in Key West or something with these flat tops. And they had dominated in the 1980s. There's still the vast majority of them on the Ocean Boulevard were flat tops. At any rate, fell in love with it. I'd like to thank Chris Nason for the beautiful drawings that were done that enhanced and our application for that very much, much, much appreciated. Lorelei Costa, I'd like to thank her. She is the director of the Outer Banks Community Foundation, and their home is 13 Skyline Road, which is a beautiful flat top, and it's being restored, and they're keeping it up, and it's just great. And it's just been really, really cool. And lastly, I'd like to give kudos to Matt Neal, the young builder, because he's built right by our neighborhood what I would call a Neo flat top, and that's exactly what it is. And imitation is the sincerest form of flattery, and I just think this shows the importance. When we saw our home in the front page of the, or when I'll speak for myself, when I saw my home on the front page of the Coastal Times, I said, oh my God, my privacy is gone. They know who I am, where I live, and where it is. But I looked at a bigger picture, and that was, hey, look, Kill-Devil Hills, Nag's Head, Kitty Hawk, we've got a historic commission too, and we're doing pretty darn good. Our history doesn't just go back to 79. It goes way back to the 1940s, about 70 years, when they first built these architectural gems. Thank you for your time. It's just a great town to live in. You are all very supportive, and I made it in under 3 minutes.
Thank you, Ms. Scudas. Appreciate that. No further public comment. I'll close that at this time. No old business. Under new business, public hearing, Historic Landmarks Commission designation of 156 Wax Myrtle Trail as historic landmark. Historic Landmarks Commission report by Chairperson Lee Whitley. Good evening, Lee.
Good evening, everybody. Following up Steve's comments, and Matt's presentation, I don't feel like I have a whole lot to add to it, except that our meeting on December 27th, when we looked at the Gudas' house on Wax Myrtle Trail, it was unanimous that it be included in the Historic Landmark program. And I don't really have much more to add. Everybody felt the same way I did. So,
give us a second. Does anybody have any questions for Ms. Whitley while she's here? Before you make a decision on this, thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay, great.
Appreciate
Thanks.
It. Council, I'm sure you've all looked through this packet, having to do with Mr. I'm sorry. Thank you.
It might be very short, but we need to have it.
I want to ask our town attorney to conduct a public hearing for us in this matter.
And Sheila, was there a sign-up sheet specifically for this? And Mr. Gudas, can I assume that you would like your comments to be brought into the public hearing for the actual historic designation?
Yes, sir.
Perfect. No one signed up, Chief Cole?
No, sir.
So we'll open the public hearing for the consideration of designation of 156 Wax Myrtle Trail as a historic landmark. If there anyone in the audience who would like to speak, who hasn't already spoken about this designation? Seeing no one, Mr. Mayor, we'll consider Mr. Gudas' comments as part of the public hearing. I'm assuming that he meant to do that. Sometimes we put multiple sheets out and people speak a little early, but no one else wishing to speak, I'll close the public hearing.
Thank you.
Back to you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you.
Motion to approve, Tom.
Counsel, I need a motion. Thanks, Gary. I would never figure that out, believe it or not. Need a motion to approve.
No, I made a motion to approve.
Oh, you're making a motion. I was going to ask for a motion, but if you've made the motion, I'll accept that. We have a motion to approve ZTA. Let me get the number here real quick. No, Historic Landmarks Commission report, Chairman, for 156 Waxmortal Trail, it's historic landmark. Have a motion to do so?
Second.
Have a second? Any further discussion?
I'd like to say one thing.
Yes.
This was an excellent package that was put together. It was very well done, and also it's backed up by a classic example. I mean, I've driven by and looked at that site. That's a no-brainer. So.
I agree. Slam dunk is what's worth
it. Yeah, slam dunk.
All in favor of the...
One second, Tom. Gary brought up a good question. I did prepare some drawings for the Gudises, and I don't want to stand in the way of their application in any way. I wasn't compensated for it, but nonetheless, I don't want to vote on something that could be a conflict.
I don't think you have a choice.
I don't think you have, if you don't have any financial interest, right. I don't think you have the ability to avoid voting.
I don't mind voting. I'm not trying to.
You just
I'm not trying to hide anything, and if it is a conflict, then just tell me.
We didn't pay.
Council, all in favor of the motion to designate 156 Wax Myrtle Trail as historic landmark, please indicate by saying aye. Motion is made and carried to designate this particular property as a historic landmark. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Good presentation. Item B, refer to Planning Board for Council reconsideration, Section 17, the Council Rules of Procedure, ZTA Amendment, ZTA 1703, originally recommended by the Planning Board on December 5th, 2017. As amended, requested by Mayor Pro Tem Chris Nason. Mr. Nason?
Well, thank you, Mr. Mayor. What made me think about this was our most recent, was the Planning Board's discussion of stormwater, which we recently, as a board, voted on to allow Wes Haskett, our planning administrator, some leeway to compel applicants in cases where he felt it was necessary to do stormwater plans. And in thinking about what we voted on before, also thinking about some other folks who spoke, it was brought up that this could be, this could lead to additional lot coverage. And I guess I wanted to ask the Planning Board to revisit that, and I wanted to do that in specific ways. I'm interested in providing a bit of a carrot and a stick approach to this. So taking into account some of the comments that were made last time to come up with a middle ground to encourage folks to do stormwater plans of their own volition and then allow them the benefit of some of these lot coverage changes. But then the benefit to the town would be that if they wanted to take advantage of these, they'd have to go ahead and provide an engineered stormwater plan. So that would be increased cost, it would be increased protection for the town, and thus I've written up a motion to that extent, and I'd ask the Planning Board to consider this. So the motion reads accordingly, refer the September 5th, 2017 Planning Board recommendation, ZTA 1703, regarding lot coverage, back to the Planning Board for its reconsideration, with the following new subsections, H and I to be added to subparagraph 6 in part 1 of Article 3 of the recommended ZTA. And here are the two new sections. H, open slatted decks constructed over pervious material not exceeding a total of 25% of the footprint area of the adjacent single family dwelling shall not contribute to lot coverage. So allow some folks to take into account the fact that if you've got a deck over sand, that water's going to go through and it's going to go into the ground fairly effectively. It doesn't give them carte blanche. It just says that of the footprint, 25% would be able to be exempted from lot coverage. And then in addition, section I, which would say those allowances and or exemptions listed in subsections G and H. G is the one relating to pools, which got us hung up last time. So if they want to take advantage, once again, of the pool one, then they would need to, and I'll read the rest of it, G or H of the subparagraph 6 shall be available only to an applicant for a building slash zoning permit of a single-family dwelling or adjacent swimming pool or adjacent open slotted deck over pervious material upon presentation of a survey with all applicable requirements, including plan certification for a lot disturbance and stormwater management permit, as described in section 36-171, parentheses 3 of the Town Code of Ordinances. That's what I propose, and that's my motion.
Thank you, Chris. Do I have a second?
Before you go there, Tom, his motion is out of, you know, according to our rules, is out of order. That was passed. Margin of 3-2, section 19 of our rules of order, part 15 says, basically that can only be brought up by a member who voted on the prevailing side. And because he used the word reconsideration, to reconsider the motion must be made by a member who voted with the prevailing side. Motion must be made in the same meeting at which the original vote was taken. Cannot interrupt the deliberation and all that. But because you used the word reconsideration, we're going to put this off the agenda, and he can make a motion to bring it back up. It's not to reconsider that motion.
It's actually a different motion, and there's some changes to it, but hence the reason.
To put it on the agenda again has to come from either Fred or myself.
I understood his motion to be asking the planning board to reconsider it.
Exactly.
A motion to reconsider under Robert's rules and our rules of procedure is a different kind of motion. And what that's talking about is at that meeting, that's the only time you can make a motion to reconsider the actual vote that occurred. That's not what's occurring here. I don't think this is out of order. I don't think this is against the rules of procedure that the town has.
I'm not asking.
I think it is
appropriate for him to vote to send it back.
We're not asking to vote on the substance of it. I want to give people some background. I want to have people understand what I'm talking about.
But to bring it back.
The motion to reconsider
that's,
is an actual vote on the substance, and that's not what's being requested here.
Well, actually it is.
And the substance has changed.
And change in the substance.
But we can agree to disagree, but it's within the rules of order that the motion is valid.
Yeah, he's asking simply for planning board to look at it again. He's not saying that we have to reconsider it right now. He's asking the planning board to look at it. As I see
either way, bringing it back, he brought it back to reconsider. His motion should have been to send it back to the planning board, reconsider.
That's what the motion is.
I read the motion.
He used the word reconsider. I waited until he read it.
I think
I know what it is. It's a technicality.
Okay,
but
I'm going to revise my motion. I will say to consider.
It's in writing, and it shouldn't even be on the agenda.
But
to reconsider.
But by that rationale, you can never look at anything you've
ever
voted
on. No,
you can.
You just have to do it appropriately.
I disagree. I don't think this is inappropriate.
I know you disagree.
We're trying to.
I agree with Mr. Nason. I don't think it's inappropriate. I think it's an appropriate motion that the council could consider, and the planning board can take it back up. I think you are unfortunately misconstruing the reference to reconsider to be a different kind of motion that is not before the council tonight. It's in either case you are reconsidering, but this is not a motion to reconsider that is a particular technical procedural mechanism under Robert's rules and under the town's rules of procedure. I believe that the motion is appropriate.
I believe that it's not. I don't think it's appropriate for him to bring it back at this point, this way.
What other way would he bring it back?
It could never come back then.
Yeah.
He could never talk about it ever again.
I don't think that's the case. I think
you can bring anything back. You just have to do it appropriately.
I think he's done it appropriately. I think that the only way under your rules to block reconsider, and here this will help explain this too. If you look at section 16, it says to prevent reconsideration for 6 months. Well,
that's
they use
right.
the term reconsideration again, but the motion to reconsider that you're referencing can only be done at the same meeting. You can't also have it extend for 6 months and have it be the same meeting. Clearly, you can use the word reconsider in two different fashions, one being the technical procedural mechanism of the motion to reconsider at the same meeting of the substance of the vote, which is not what is occurring here, and another being the consideration of reconsidering the matter in whole. And the only way to block it is to use 16 immediately following the substantive motion to block reconsideration for a period of 6 months. That did not occur, to my recollection, at the initial substantive vote. So Mr. Nason is within his realm to ask for reconsideration by the planning board and to go through the process of reconsidering the zoning text amendment again. Whether or not y'all want to do that, that's up to you. But whether or not he can do it, I believe it's within order.
I'd like to second the motion. By Chris, yes.
And you second the motion?
Yes.
We have a motion to second, counsel. We've heard the attorney's comments. We've heard Mr. McDonald's comments. Any further discussion?
Well, we decided this less than 3 months ago. I don't see that it's a need to send it back. Chris is talking about storm runoff. One of the biggest issues that we've had in this town is stormwater runoff. We just spent $500,000 to fix East Dogwood and 12, purchasing property. If we allow, and you have to remember, in Southern Shores, we live beside water. It's all around us. 30% is, I think, generous for lot coverage throughout our community. It seems that we're going to build bigger on our lots, which is going to create more runoff, more flooding.
Pardon me. You're arguing about against something that we've all discussed and is left alone. All Chris is asking for is to put this back.
I understand, but it shouldn't. I don't think it should go back there. We settled it.
I'm not saying this is the last word. I'm trying to go through an appropriate process to bring it up in last meeting to give folks a chance to think about it. In this meeting, to give a chance to introduce a motion, and then the planning board will do their work, and they'll come back, and they may disagree. But I can say for sure that the planning board did agree several months ago with most of what I'm saying. Now, whether the old council voted for that or not is beyond it. We've got a new council, and they've been seated, and I believe that this is appropriate, and I'm trying to come up with a middle ground so that we're able to do some other things. Now, I'm not going to go beyond that in the substantive.
Well, who's the middle ground for?
For homeowners. For
I don't think homeowners are asking for it.
That's not true. There's a lot of folks who have.
All right, let's go back to the code right survey we did. We spent a lot of money and a lot of time on that. 61% of the people that responded, and there were 729 people that did, said that they were in favor of means of reducing stormwater runoff into the streets, and the same 61% said an adjoining property. Mm-hmm. So what you're saying, you're a proponent of increasing lot coverage, which in effect could increase stormwater runoff.
That's not what I heard.
That's not the intent.
Well, you're saying reconsider, but you are reconsidering with bias. And your bias is you're trying to increase
to be reasonable. If a person has a gravel driveway, it is reasonable to expect that water is going to go through that. That is reasonable. What we've got now is not reasonable. But I think that it's also reasonable to expect for people who, and this came up in the last conversation, for people who want to take advantage of additional things like water in the pool or deck over sand, which also is reasonable that water goes through, to make them do a little bit of extra work and prove that they're meeting stormwater requirements. It is in the town's best interest to have everybody do stormwater plans for their lots.
That's a separate issue.
It isn't separate to lot coverage. It is intertwined with lot coverage. So I disagree with that, and in fact, I think this is a better stormwater management thing, and it's a bit of a carrot and a stick, and I said that. We are encouraging folks to do the right thing and to control their own water. They're not doing it now.
Well, they should be, because it's the law that you've got to maintain your water on your property. You can't let it impact other people.
I'm open to the discussion, but let's, we don't even have a final.
Gentlemen, we're debating something that we're not, that has not even been brought back to the planning board yet. When it comes back from them, the next time, then we can debate it. There's no point in us debating this tonight, because it's not going to happen tonight. We're not going to change anything that's already been passed.
Well, that's not true, Tom. This was brought forward from the planning board with recommendations, voted on by council, and settled. So it's coming back up. We debated it then, if you want to look at it from that perspective. I mean, that argument doesn't...
We didn't debate the provisions that Chris has brought to us tonight. We did not debate that.
We debated everything that was brought to us, and
that's what
that,
I said.
That deck over sand, the pool, all that was in
we
that.
We did not include any consideration given for stormwater management as a requirement of building a home.
Stormwater management was a different issue, and we settled that at a different meeting in the last month.
It's not settled. That is at Wester's discretion. This is actually...
It's not. It has to have a plan.
No, all we are doing is sending this back, asking the planning board to reconsider. As the mayor has mentioned, we can debate the merits of each of these cases once it comes back before us. But this is also an opportunity to use some of those low-impact development strategies and guidelines like gravel parking areas, pervious pavers, and various other methods. Now, if they were to do this, Chris's motion would require them to get a storm water management plan. It's the carrot and the bait, and get them to use some of these low impact development guidelines, get them to use pervious pavers and everything, but they'll have to show that it works.
But you know, there is a concern about pervious pavers. You got to maintain them. Who's going to enforce the maintenance of those pervious pavers by a homeowner?
There's 100 different pervious pavers out there and 100 different ways to install them.
But any way you look at it, we're increasing lot coverage. I
disagree with that, because what we're doing is redefining and tweaking somewhat what is covered toward lot coverage. Now, what's being proposed here in Mr. Nason's, write-up there is not out of the ordinary for other communities out here. We're
call
just...
Call for a vote.
You say it's not out of ordinary for other communities out here. The other thing is, we know we have flood issues. We know we have...
That has nothing
issues.
To do with what we're talking
sure
about
it does.
Here, though.
If you increase the water runoff, which it would...
We're not.
It would not increase the
water. We're not.
You can argue and say that, but, and I can step right
well,
back
he's proposing
and say,
getting an engineer to say that.
Wes is not an engineer, so I'm saying that if they want to take advantage of some of these provisions, they've got to pay for the engineer to do the calculations to prove that they're complying with it. And we are not the only community that is surrounded by water and that has water issues. Just attend any Nag's Head meeting, and you're going to get your fill of it.
That's right.
So what we're trying to do is take a proactive approach to it. This integrates lot coverage and stormwater, and I think it works. But I'll save my further comments until we hear from what the planning board has to say, because they may alter it, they may change it, and then we'll consider it at that point.
Council, I have a motion and a second. We've had a lengthy discussion about this, and I'd like to now ask for all in favor of sending this back to the planning board for their further consideration, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, same sign.
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. The motion's made and carried to send this back to the planning board for their consideration, further consideration. Thank you. Item C. Item C is a resolution in opposition of the proposed 2019-2024 National Outer Continental Shelf Oil and Gas Leasing Program, released January the 4th, 2018 by the U.S. Department of Energy's Bureau of Ocean Energy Management, BOEM. This was a resolution that I asked the town manager to draft for me, and I reviewed it and made a couple of minor changes, which you'll see. And I would now need a second to
consider this resolution for passage.
Second.
That's you, Gary? Thank you. Second by Gary. Sheila. Any further discussion, council? Anybody want to make comments about this?
I'll just add that I just sat in on the tourist board meeting this past month, and we also acted in conjunction with similar measures. So this is happening across Dare County, having more access to administrators other than just one meeting in Raleigh. Kildavel Hills is applied for that also. So it's very much in keeping with our neighbors.
I'd like to also add that this is a very rapidly developing story, and that my understanding, again, is that Dare County officials have already met with state officials and federal officials. I expect that tomorrow the town of Nag's Head may be adopting a resolution similar to ours. So it's a fast-moving story anyway.
I believe it is important to get they call it ahead of the curve on this one a little bit, and not be the last person to say, by the way, we'd like to tag along. I attended a conference. I may have mentioned this before, and if I did, I apologize. I attended a Beaches Waterways Inlets conference in near Wilmington, some months ago, and this issue came up at that time. And the consensus there by most of the speakers, both for and against the concept, and for and against it in principle and otherwise, was that we're dealing with a federal government property, which is the offshore part of our coast. And we don't have a whole lot to say about it, but we can make our voices heard, and that's exactly what we're trying to do. We don't agree with what they're planning to do. We don't agree with the concept or the philosophy or anything else to go do with it, our hands are kind of tied because we don't have any ownership interest in those waters. But I think we'd be remiss not to speak up. So that's why I had Peter do this resolution. We've had a motion and a second. Any further discussion?
Let me ask you, have you taken any kind of poll of what the residents of Southern Shores want? I mean, I understand where you're coming from, and I'm all for it, but is that what the people want?
Well, the feedback I'm getting from people that talk to me about it, and that probably a half a dozen or so have mentioned to me, why aren't we doing something about this, or what can we do about this? I think the consensus is, I can't speak for everybody, but I think most of us in the town agree with what
okay.
The state's trying to do, which is prevent this.
Just curious as...
No, I haven't had a public forum on this.
Okay.
I didn't feel it was necessary. I felt we're all kind of going the same direction to protect our resources, our livelihood.
No, I understand.
Okay, thank you, Fred. Good question. Good point. Motion and a second. Any further discussion? Need a motion to approve this resolution, council? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Motion is made and carried 5-0. At this time, I think it's time for mayor's comments and
general
public comment. I got somebody else wants to speak. I got to learn to use the agenda. Debbie Newberry. Good evening, Debbie.
Hey, how you doing? I just have a couple quick items to bring up. I heard something about auxiliary houses here, and I hate to say it, I wasn't at the meeting when that was all voted on, but I really thought the auxiliary buildings that we were having were either, you know, like it could be like a bedroom, it could have either a bathroom in it or a kitchen. It couldn't have both. And I didn't think it was meant for separate living quarters, and it sounded like somebody was saying that today. So it was just a thought or a concern of mine, and as we move forward. And the comment that we had here of dogs on the beach in making this a longer time for this or more time on the beach, I honestly, you know, love dogs. I think it's a great idea for people who are actually compelled to do the right thing, and I'm actually think it's a good thing. However, I think we need to have a lot more controls in place where we're watching people and we start ticketing them. When people let their dogs run, when they let them poop all over the beach and they don't clean it up, and I think that's our biggest problem. So if we can take care of that and just ticket people that aren't doing it, but I think it's a wonderful idea, something to look at. As far as the stormwater planning, I think one of the items here to really take care of this is let's require it for every single plan. We have an issue here at the beach. This is something that is ongoing. I watch them take all the trees out. Okay, take your trees out, that's fine, but you got to keep that water. When you have the site, you build up the house and you're putting the slopes on either side, I'm sorry, it's going into your neighbor's yard or out on the street. So I think everybody should be doing this, and that's one of the things that the planning board should be looking at when they go into this. And then I also thought it was kind of interesting in the conversation that we had here that there were two times when we were making a motion for something to go to the planning board. And when it was something that... it was, you know, always a 3-2 vote, but it seemed like it was something when the three people that we knew were going to vote positive for something wanted it to go through or didn't want it to go through. There was plenty of discussion, and there should be discussion, or decided there should be discussion on this, so you were making up your mind before it ever went to the planning board. And then all of a sudden, when we got to the other one, Chris, where you wanted it to go to the planning board, then nobody wanted a discussion on that. You wanted to go to the planning board and then have the discussion later. And so I don't think we should have it both ways. It seems to me, send it to the planning board. Let them do their work. Let them look at that, because both of these are very complicated issues. Not that I agree that this one should go back to the planning board, other than make it separate and just a stormwater plan. But I think both of the issues are very complicated issues. Planning board, that's their job, is to figure out the complicated issues, look at everything, and come back to us. Thanks.
Thank you. No further sign-ups for public comment. So this time I'll close public comment. Under other business, I just have two quick items. I'd like to also welcome David Bradley as our new Public Works Director. David brings a level of experience and skills that will serve him well in this new role. I wish him the best, and I'm glad to have him join our team. Thank you, David. Glad to have you here. Finally, I would like to recognize Ross Mitchell for his friendship and his service to our community. Through the SSCA over the past many years, I think a total of 6 years or more, Ross has served the SSCA and served our community. Ross and Nita are, in my mind, great examples of giving back to our community, and I thank them. Thank you, Ross. I want to close on a positive note, if we could. At this time, I'd call on my Mayor Pro Tem. Do you have any comments?
Not today. No.
Thank you. Gary?
No, sir.
Fred?
No more.
Jim?
I'd like to mention a couple things. One of them is the Capital Improvements Committee is meeting this week, and that's a great opportunity to offer input as we try to prioritize what some of the road projects are that we'll be working on next year. Another thing I want to address is a pattern that I've been seeing since I started sitting as a council member up here, and that is the day after a council meeting up here, we start getting, as councilmen or council members, emails that rehash some of the things that were discussed up here at council. These things are trying to be rehashed even though they were already settled. This has taken up a tremendous amount of time and resources, not just of council members up here, but more importantly, the town staff. Some of these emails have made what I consider some pretty rude demands, basically, like meeting information request for a certain, by a certain deadline that would interrupt people's travel plans, and it just totally inundates them and takes them away from what they're supposed to be doing. But more importantly, after the last council meeting, one of these emails started again, but this time it got a town attorney involved, and now we're facing a bill of $2,000 in attorney fees. And so what I'd like to ask the council here is that we go back and look at our rules of procedures and how we conduct business here. It should not be, I should not be able to turn to Mr. Gallup and ask him to do research that's going to cost us thousands of dollars. Likewise, I should not be able to make demands of town staff that's going to take days of their time to research and produce documents that are sometimes non-existent. So anyway, with this long-winded council member comments, I'd like to lay that request at the council's feet that we ask it to look at our rules and procedures. Who can authorize an attorney to embark on research? What are the limits of a council member from making requests or demanding information of town staff?
Thank you, Jim.
Closed session.
Do you have anything else?
Closed session.
Do you have anything else? At this time, I'd ask for a motion to go into closed session under North Carolina General Statutes and 143-318.11A6. Consider a personnel matter regarding an individual officer employee of the town requested by the town manager HR director.
I'll second that.
Have a second. All in favor? Count. All in favor?
Aye.
All in favor?
Aye.
Who made it?
He made the motion. I second. Yeah.
Recess for about 5 minutes.
Go ahead.
Let's give ourselves. let's
Hey, Bonnie, can you hold the door open?
Let's convene the open session first.
Hmm?
We have to go back into open session.
We just did.
Yeah, we did.
I got it. I thought we just closed the closed session. That's all right.
It's 8 o'clock, Tom. Everybody's gone but us.
Not everybody.
Hey, Bonnie, can you give me the piece of paper with the name of it?
Is he rolling?
Yes.
Okay, we're good.
I make a motion.
To create
a position of deputy town manager.
Planner slash code enforcement. Department head. Do we need to set the rates, Bonnie?
Yep.
Do you want to approve them?
Like to approve the
approve the starting grade what?
I believe that the exact amount was $13,577 was the increase.
No, but he wants the rates of the classifications, what he's asking. The low, the high, and the starting.
Oh, the minimum max. What's the minimum?
$63,741.
At a minimum salary of $63,000.
Well, I'm sorry, the hiring rate, $63,741. Minimum salary, $66,927. Maximum salary, $95,607.
Exactly what Ben said.
Okay. And to have the...
And to have it budgeted in the July 1, 2018...
18, 19
budget. Does that cover it? Need a second.
Second.
Any further discussion, Council? Nope. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion is made and carried. Thank you.
Yeah. Make a motion, we close.
I'll second.
Any further discussion of that one? No. All in favor?
Aye.
Meeting's adjourned. Thank you.